sing happy birthday. Cheryl Carrio will be here next weekend to do communion on October 10th. Our council meeting will be October 12th at 6:15. And Jeannie Sheeman suffered a stroke and is in the hospital in Michigan. If you would like to send a card or a note, the address is in the bulletin. Does anybody else have any other announcements? Patty?
Yes, most of you heard this already, but Mary Lou Kellogg, who was one of our Winter Texans, passed away on Friday. So keep Clark in your prayers. We'll try to get an address. I'm not sure we have it correct in our church records, so we'll try to get an address.
Thank you, Pastor.
She's the one who put the plan.
We and Mary Ellen yesterday, and they want to say hi. They're up in Fargo, so here's the church.
Tell them we said hello as well.
I want to thank everybody for their prayers and thoughts. Church is doing very well after early surgery and been released from physical therapy. So, again, thank you.
That's good to hear. Joyce, you got something?
I just wanted to say Mary Lou was the one that played a clown here in our church.
She was a trained clown, and her clown name was Lulu.
And then Don Taylor is, I know like Vernon asked me, but we're not real sure, but he did get some kind of prognosis that's not looking too good from what they've been hearing. So just keep him in your prayers. And we'll try to find out some more if we can, okay? Anybody else have anything? Go ahead and get started with the Lord is in this holy temple. Children of God and bestows on them the Holy Spirit. Go ahead and sing our gathering hymn, Praise to the Father, page 517. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Our Lord Jesus, you have endured the doubts and foolish questions and rejections. Forgive us for trying to judge over you, and grant us the confident faith to acknowledge you as Lord. Amen.
Good morning, everyone.
Good
The first reading is from the second chapter of Genesis. The Lord God said, "It is not good that the man should be alone. I will make him a helper as his partner." So out of the ground, the Lord God formed every animal of the fields and every bird of the air and brought them to the man to see what he would call them. And whatever the man called every living creature, that was its name. The man gave names to all cattle and to the birds of the air and to every animal of the field. But for the man, there was not found a helper as his partner. So the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man, and he slept. Then he took one of his ribs and closed up its place with flesh. And the rib that the Lord God had taken from the man, he made into a woman and brought her to the man. Then the man said, "This at last is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. This one shall be called woman, for out of man this one was taken. Therefore, a man leaves his father and his mother and clings to his wife, and they become one flesh." Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God. We will now read Psalm 8 responsively. Our Lord, how exalted is your name in all the world.
Our God has been praised with children, and your majesty is praised
above heaven. You have set up a stronghold against your adversaries to quell the enemy and the leader.
When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars you have set in their courses.
What is man that you should be mindful of him, or the son of man that you should seek him out?
You have made him a little lower than the angels. You adore him before your mouth.
You gave him mastery over the works of your hands. You put all things under his feet.
All sheep and oxen, even the wild beasts of the field.
The birds of the air, the fish of the sea, and whatsoever walks in the paths of the sea. The second reading is from the first chapter of Hebrews. Long ago, God spoke to our ancestors in many and various ways by the prophets. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by a son, whom he appointed heir of all things, through whom he also created the worlds. He is a reflection of God's glory and the exact imprint of God's very being. And he sustains all things by his powerful word. When he made purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high, having become as much superior to angels as the name he has inherited is more excellent than theirs. Now God did not subject the coming worlds in which we are speaking to angels. But someone has testified somewhere, "What are human beings that you are mindful to them, or mortals that you care for them? You have made them for a little while lower than the angels. You have crowned them with glory and honor, subjecting all things under their feet. Now in subjecting all things to them, God left nothing outside their control. As it is, we do not see everything in subjection to them, but we do see Jesus, who for a little while was made lower than the angels, now crowned with glory and honor because of the suffering of death, so that by grace of God he might taste death for everyone. It was fitting that God, for whom and through whom all things exist, and bringing many children to glory, should make the pioneer of their salvation perfect through sufferings. For the one who sanctifies and those who are sanctified all have one Father. For this reason, Jesus is not ashamed to call them brothers and sisters, saying, "I will proclaim your name to my brothers and sisters. In the midst of the congregation, I will praise you." Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Lord, we shall be found. You have heard.
10th chapter. Some Pharisees came, and to test Jesus they asked, "Is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife?" He answered them, "What did Moses command you?" They said, "Moses allowed a man to write a certificate of dismissal and to divorce her." But Jesus said to them, "Because of your hardness of heart, he wrote this commandment for you. But from the beginning of creation, God made them male and female. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no one separate." Then in the house, the disciples asked him again about this matter. He said to them, "Whoever divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery against her. And if she divorces her husband and marries another, she commits adultery." People were bringing little children to him in order that he might touch them. And the disciples spoke sternly to them. But when Jesus saw this, he was indignant and said to them, "Let the little children come to me. Do not stop them, for it is to such as these that the kingdom of God belongs. Truly I tell you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter." And he took them up in his arms, laid his hands on them, and blessed them. Word of God, word of life, this is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Joseph's righteousness in choosing to divorce his pregnant wife Mary.
But in Moses' day, some divorces were born of hard hearts and were not based on infidelity. The regulations Moses imposed did not specifically permit divorce, but assumed it. The regulations were that a certificate be given. One could not get married while being married to another. In other words, you couldn't simply divorce to marry because you wanted to marry someone else, period. Moses' permission of divorce was not intended to condone the practice. The Pharisees knew what Moses did. If Jesus contradicted Moses in anything, then they would have legal grounds to destroy him. Jesus, on the other hand, came not to destroy them, but to save them. Jesus speaks the truth about marriage. Even though Moses permitted a certificate of divorce, God's will for husband and wife is to be one flesh and to last for life. Honoring and upholding marriage vows brings honor and glory to God. Marriage is to last until death. The Bible teaches us to enter into marriage carefully and reverently. Divorce is to be avoided at all costs. Instead, for some people, marriages are not based on the right principles, or no principles at all, or with the misconception that is expected of them. Boredom and lust have replaced love and honor for spouses. Less and less people are getting married these days, citing that they don't need a certificate of marriage to be married. And for the ones that are getting married, are they entering it carefully and reverently? The Bible teaches us to enter marriage carefully and with deep respect. Divorce is to be avoided at all costs. Honoring and upholding marriage vows brings honor and glory to God. This is precisely what we should be teaching the little children. We should be teaching the children that every husband and wife should treasure one another as long as they draw breath. A spouse is the most precious gift from the Creator, who is uniquely gifted for you with oneness, delight, and companionship. These gifts are meant for all who enter this holy estate. God's will for marriage is clear when the Son of God taught that what therefore God has joined together, let not man separate. And what Jesus says here applies to all marriages, and not only for Christians entering marriage. Now God gave us the gift of marriage already in paradise, before sin came into the world with the creation of Eve. God brought her to Adam to end loneliness. Every husband and wife should treasure one another as long as they draw breath. But is it still a holy estate? Our civilization today has tinkered with it, and redefined it as something that is man-made rather than God-given. Marriage has lost God's design and purpose. Now, when Jesus warned no one to separate what God has joined together in this marital oneness, he was in agreement with his Father's will. When in Ephesians, St. Paul refers to the mystery of the oneness of husband and wife, he is basing this mystery upon Christ and his church. Since Christ is eternal with no beginning or end, his being one with his church comes before earthly marriages. Sadly, however, the Pharisees, along with this wicked generation, want the freedom to do with marriage what they wanted and end it when convenient. And since Moses allowed it, they would use the teachings of Jesus that marriage was lifelong to discredit him. Do you see the misinterpretation of marriage in this generation? Do you see many entering the sanctity of marriage without regard to the holiness of marriage? The holiness of marriage is what we should be teaching our little children. And what are the disciples? What do they think about Jesus' teaching? Now, the disciples of Jesus were also troubled about his teaching on divorce, because it made them feel uncomfortable. Perhaps they had close friends who were divorced and remarried. What would God say to them? Jesus clearly upholds the lifelong union of marriage. He said that when a divorced person remarries, they are committing adultery. Can we say that God's word is true except in this case or in that case? To be sure, the Bible does allow for the possibility of divorce in instances of adultery and malicious desertion. But because divorce also involves sin, it requires repentance and forgiveness. If one breaks the law at one point, he is guilty of breaking all of it, writes St. James. And ending what God has joined together is sin, as is all sin against God's holy will, regardless of the specifics of the case. Instead of justifying or rationalizing divorce, flee to Christ for mercy. He knows your heart. Demonstrate repentance and obedience to God's word. Although divorce is a serious matter in God's opinion, it is not the unforgivable sin. If you confess your sins to God and ask for forgiveness, you are forgiven and can move on with your life. From this point forward, you should commit to honoring God's word pertaining to marriage. Hear what your Heavenly Father says to you. I took your sin as my own, all of it. I was separated from my Father on the cross because of it, but now you are mine forever. I will never leave you or forsake you. And it is in this undying love of Christ for us that we find hope and peace and forgiveness. Only sinners and beggars are comforted to hear that. God has joined us poor lowly sinners to the Holy Savior in the union of endless love that always gives a refuge to lost sinners and restores the joy of heaven to the lowest and most despised. For the divorced, there is hope in Christ, for as he patiently taught his disciples about the sanctity of marriage, he patiently forgives you and welcomes you into God's family. The disciples heard what Jesus said about the adultery of remarriage, but then they do something rather strange. They immediately rebuke the mothers who brought their children to be blessed by Jesus. Children are a gift of God when and where it pleases him to give them. Jesus says that they are great examples of his kingdom of grace because they have nothing to offer. They can only receive. They have no impressive resumes to qualify them for heaven, no impressive good works. And yet what does Jesus say? Whoever does not receive the kingdom of God like a child shall not enter it. When Jesus receives a child in holy baptism, that is a clear picture of God's grace, welcoming a child into heaven. What can the child offer God? God takes the sinner and joins them to Christ in a holy washing of water, and his word makes them an heir of heaven. These little ones can only receive God's grace, and that's the way it is for all of us. For all of us, Jesus' disciples, whether they be infants or adults. Jesus took them in his arms and would not let anyone get in the way for his beloved children. And do you know what? He is still patient and loving with us. His forgiveness does not entitle us to change his design for marriage, but in confessing our sin, he will always forgive. After all, what God has joined together, no one, not even the devil or any power, can separate. Jesus remains completely devoted to us, and in that love we can all rest securely into all eternity. Amen. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the preservation of marriage, that God will defend husbands and wives from every assault of the enemy, strengthen them in their faithfulness and loving service to one another, and grant them joy in the gift of children according to his will. For grace that the church may always welcome little ones with joy, that nothing would hinder them from being brought to the Savior and blessed by being placed into his loving arms. For those who bring offerings, those who do good in our congregation, all the people here present who await from the Lord great and abundant mercy. For the faithful who have gone before us and now rest in Christ, let us give thanks to the Lord and ask him to bring us with them to the marriage feast of the Lamb and his kingdom, which has no end. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Go ahead and sing our sermon hymn, Day by Day. God made us a people through our baptism into Christ, living together in trust and hope. We confess our faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty,
Creator of heaven and earth.
I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord.
He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He ascended into hell. On the third day, He rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Silence of our hearts.
We also lift up those all who are affected by the COVID-19 virus. May God's healing presence give them peace and hope in their time of need. For those who have experienced your unconditional love, we thank you, gracious God. Lord, in your mercy. You share in our experiences and struggles. Bless all who live with any mental or physical disability. Inspire creative communities, spaces, and environments that are accessible and hospitable. Lord, in your mercy. You promise eternal life to all your children. Thank you for the people of faith who have gone before us. Strengthen our trust we have in you. Lord, in your mercy. Receive these prayers, O God, and those in our hearts known only to you, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please stand and we will sing the Lord's Prayer.
I will be your God.
filled with the Holy Spirit, go in peace, serve the Lord as your neighbor.
Done.